Good morning. I am Double H here with Sasha Morgan, and you are watching the 2016 International WFTDA Division I Playoffs live from Columbia, South Carolina, being hosted by the WFTDA and Columbia Quad Squad. Good afternoon, Sasha.
Good afternoon, Double H. Fifth place game about to come up in front of us, and I believe, if I'm not mistaken, the first time we've had a fifth place game with two teams not in the United States, or not located in the United States.
And the number seven seed coming into this tournament, of course, was Rainy City, and they are ranked number 26 in the WFTDA, and Crime City, ranked number 19 in the WFTDA, was the number five seed. So Crime City playing for a foothold here on the number five seed.
Looking to place exactly where they finish, but Rainy City, no matter how they finish, will come up from where their initial seeding was.
Good opportunity for Rainy City, who's had a tremendous weekend. In order to get here, they had to overtake Santa Cruz yesterday at 4 o'clock. I don't even know what day it is. It's Sunday, right?
It's Sunday.
And so here we are.
And they beat Steel City in the morning, but fell to Jacksonville in the quarterfinal round.
Perfect. And, of course, Crime City bested Columbia Saturday at 6 o'clock. They bested Steel City, as well, as we talked about. And the first game of the weekend, they also...
They dropped to Atlanta in that quarterfinal game.
Yep. Atlanta having a really good weekend, which their game is going to be coming up later this evening. But ahead of us, we have two teams, Rainy City, Crime City. Let's go over some rosters.
Skating for the Crime City Rollers A team is going to be number 0347, Hannah Pay. Number 1, Below Me. Number 100, Curly Whore. Number 12, Fricks Road. Number 1337, Shootette. Number 177, Valshut. Number 2, Sister Stitch. Number 20, Trippy. Number 22, Juicy Butter. Number 3, Prince Sophia. Number 53, Dyke Stalker. Number 610, Sexual Harassment. And number 9 is Kicks.
And for Rainy City, number 11, Faye Roberts. Number 12, Wild. Number 138, Vivian Lethal, the captain. Number 38, Fatal Blonde. Number 419, Ruthless Philly. Number 48, Smack Mamba. Number 5, Go-Go Chanel. Number 6, Missy Rascal. 666, Alex Valentine. 6955, Menace. 75, Una Bomber. 77, Liz Yateman. Number 8, Fisher. And number 88, Bruisem Banshee.
And our skating officials, crew head referee the Panty Christ, inside pack referee is DJ Jazzy Ref, jammer referees are PH Diva and calling the shots, and the outside pack refs are Davey Darko, Direwolf, and Trial and Terror, with officially hated as the alt.
Just a few seconds left before we start this game.
Hannah Pay versus Wild off of the fast girl skate start line, as Hannah Pay working her way into the outside lane, getting nudged out a little bit by Menace, but a quick recovery there by Hannah Pay, as Wild now has two blockers to beat in the front. The two blockers in the front declared out of play for Crime City, so Wild now lead for Rainy City.
Rainy City taking the jammer start line. They are the jammer line bench, and it has proven effective for them.
As Wild now running up against, it was a brace two wall, but Wild kind of split it up, challenged the link. They're now running into a triangle after getting downed in between turns one and two.
Hannah Pay has moved roughly 15 feet since that jammer start whistle.
Yeah, Rainy City is very, very good about rotating their blockers around, making sure that there's no real way for the jammers to get free in most situations. Here is Wild now in the front, looking to get past, once again, two more blockers. That is Dyke Stalker and Shootette for Crime City. And they're both declared out of play. They're going to have to let her go. 5 points picked up by Rainy City.
Nice bridging jab there by Below Me, who really had a lot of great pivoting moments yesterday.
While now approaching the back of the pack on her second scoring pass, as Hannah Pay has removed the helmet cover, stashing the star, but her pivot, Dyke Stalker, just recycled Wild all the way back. Now Wild coming back onto your screen here on the right-hand side, running into a triangle, an assist from Faye Roberts to break that triangle up, but it frees up Hannah Pay in the front.
That was the most casual offense I think I've ever seen. She just slowly dipped back, got her hip around, and cleared a path.
Wild is going to get through on the outside lane, coming into one and two, three and four, excuse me, as Rainy City will have four more to their total, 9-0, to end the first jam.
So if Rainy City wants to go long for the whole game, is that what it's going to look like? A 9-0 jam in their favor. Did you know that in addition to helmets, S1 now makes pads for roller derby? Make S1 part of your uniform. On the start line for Rainy City, Go-Go Chanel. Prince Sophia for Crime City.
Prince Sophia had, I believe, 107 points. In her most recent game here, is now she's running into Rainy City's, well, in normal situations, a triangle of doom. That's more of a quadrilateral than anything else here. Is Go-Go Chanel with a nice lane wide open on the outside. There was an attempt by Trippy to try and hold down Go-Go Chanel, but Go-Go Chanel recovered quickly. Now Trippy, they did a great job there recycling Go-Go Chanel back around to the pivot line. Go-Go Chanel working her way in, calling off the jam there as Prince Sophia was approaching the back of the pack. Rainy City will get 4 points for that jam.
We're going to take an opportunity to thank our friends at Rydell Skates. Rydell Skates, the innovative leader in the roller skating industry for over 70 years. Go to RydellSkates.com for more information. Now on the Fast Girls start line, we've got Curly Har from Crime City and Alex Valentine for Rainy City.
26 minutes and 45 seconds left to go here in the first half. Rainy City's gotten lead in both their both jams so far. Both teams operating at full strength here as Curly Har running into a back wall there. Rainy City is about to lose a blocker now, converting into what they call their triangle of doom. And that was a maneuver there by number 12, Fricks Road, to open up a lane and get Curly Har through. Lead jammer for Crime City.
That was a direction sending Yateman to the penalty box. The helmet cover has come off for Rainy City, and a penalty being assessed to Faye Roberts, also a clockwise.
Curly Har has completed a first scoring pass for 5 points here as Alex Valentine has stashed the star. Curly Har now on the outside lane and attempted a hip-to-hip contact. Did not faze Curly Har one bit. Five additional points picked up here by Crime City.
4 penalties in this game so far. All of them are direction of gameplay, so lots of aggressive offense from the front.
Curly Har right now with one opportunity here, trying to potentially take the lead there, was not going to be able to do so, calling off the jam. So a scoreless third scoring pass.
All right. Powerdyne has changed the game again with the newly redesigned Arius Platinum. Arius Platinum performance redefined. On the Fast Girl start line, number 12, Wild for Rainy City, and Hennepay 0347 for Crime City.
Both teams starting up at the pivot line with Rainy City folding back just as the jam starts. So a rollback maneuver there to basically brace in the both jammers, but Hennepay able to find the outside lane. Lead jammer status going to Crime City.
Cutting the track penalty, taking Wild off the track for Rainy City. So now a power jam in Crime City's favor.
And Crime City opting to play pure offense here as they're going to try and sweep Rainy City apart. But Rainy City looks like they've sped up the pack here as Crime City now trying to bridge them out of play, or at least drop back to get them out of play. Hennepay looking on the inside lane there, just dancing on the toe stops on the inside line. Now moving to the outside is Hennepay.
And kicks going to the penalty box for a failure to reform.
Yeah, Crime City taking a risk here and dropping their blockers back to force Rainy City out of play, as now penalty is over for Wild, looking to complete her initial pass as Hennepay is getting completely shut down in the back.
Oh no, an out of play engagement penalty being assessed to Wild. This is her second penalty of the jam, so back to the box.
We've seen an awful lot of out of play engagements called on the jammers in this tournament. I believe that's the fourth one we've seen here, as Hennepay now again trying to work on the inside lane. Crime City has goaded a blocker now in the back, of specifically the pivot, Ruthless Philly, but Ruthless Philly able to escape. And Hennepay just says, I'm done, calling off the jam. I don't want to do this anymore.
Well, she's got a whole 23 minutes and 40 seconds left of the first period to go.
Yeah.
It was a 5-0 jam in Crime City's favor. Crime City now 15, Rainy City 13, just under 7 minutes of gameplay has expired. Wild in the penalty box for her second penalty, which was a forearm. On the Fast Girl start line for Crime City, Prince Sophia, number 3, who was, you're correct, Sasha, 107 total points versus Columbia. That's 11 leads out of 15 jams. Rams.
Amazing. I got something right. As Prince Sophia now working through once again, Crime City just content to go back and play passive offense here as Prince Sophia looking to break things up. I like the movement here of Prince Sophia attempting to challenge the Lynx here and split up Rainy City's walls. Now Rainy City's captain having to drop back here to keep both sides in play. You see the drop back here because if Rainy City's blockers are declared out of play, they're going to have to let her go. It may get Wild through, but it will not get it basically won't do anybody any favors.
And I think what Rainy City realized pretty quickly in the front there is that if they're going to rotate, they've got to do it quickly. Mm-hmm. If they're not going to take that lateral movement from those back two blockers, they got to be fast. Prince Sophia is right there.
Prince Sophia once again moving in here is Rainy City is going to lose number 138, Vivian Lethal, into the penalty box. She is the captain of Rainy City. And both teams with slow-moving triangles. It's 3-on-1, 3 blockers against 1 jammer. As we are coming into turn number 4, no lead jammer status has been assessed yet, Double H.
And we have yet to make a full rotation around the pack at this, around the track. At this point, I'm not sure if we will.
We're very close, though. We got 44 seconds, and we're about 10 feet from the Rainy City triangle reaching the jammer line, unless they decide they want to roll back here.
So it's going to come down to who is freed from the box first, and it will be Crime City's blocker, Sister Stitch, and now a multiplayer being assessed.
That's to Dykestalker, who is on her way to the box. Vivian Lethal is going to rejoin the action and make it a pack advantage, favoring Rainy City. Still no lead jammers. We have now made one complete revolution around the track, and still, oh my goodness, Wild with a maneuver to the outside, but Sister Stitch with a great hit, bringing her all the way back into turn number 4. And this jam is going to time out, it looks like, with no lead jammer.
Well, that was brutal. So now, still Crime City 15, Rainy City 13, 21 minutes and 13 seconds left in the first period. I'm Double H here with Sasha Morgan, and you are watching Crime City taking on Rainy City. On the Fast Girl start line for Crime City, Curly Har, and she's going to be facing off against Fatal Blonde, number 38 for Rainy City.
Coming into jam number 6, and already 9 minutes taken off the clock, so I get the feeling a lot of slow-moving, grinding jams here. As Curly Har going off the line, going up against Fatal Blonde. Fatal Blonde with a lane on the inside. They got immediately shut down there by number 9, kicks for Crime City. Now Fatal Blonde trying to take lane to the outside here. Curly Har with a maneuver to the end, but Curly Har now switching to the out. One blocker to beat in the front. That is number 6, Missy Rascal for Rainy City. Curly Har trying to get around the outside, and an out-of-play call on the front two blockers for Rainy City. Curly Har lead jammer.
And
for
a star
crime.
Pass initiated from Fatal Blonde to Ruthless Philly. So about half a track behind Curly Har.
As Curly Har going into the back, but Rainy City has taken off. Rainy City has done a great job of getting the front and just speeding away here. But Curly Har able to get into the pack. She will pass blockers and get 4 points for her team.
Spank Alley, makers of awesome art bands, helmet covers, compression pants, and more. Go to spankalley.com.au. And taking the front line that last pass was Rainy City. I think that they have felt more confident on the back. There's a lot of turning around right now from Rainy City, and they're going to have to lock it down if they want to keep that defense solid.
Hannah Pay now jamming off the Fast Girl Skate start line against Gogo Chanel. Pack advantage is favoring Crime City as Hannah Pay trying to dance around to the outside, then to the inside, but getting shut down by the brace here with Menace as the pivot. As Hannah Pay getting brought back around. She's recovering quickly from being knocked out, though, as Gogo Chanel almost got through but got knocked to the outside, downed, and as a result having to go all the way back once again.
Blocker for Crime City headed to the penalty box to make that one and a jammer, but she's got to go all the way around. Hannah Pay, a forearm.
And we do have a lead jammer now. It is Gogo Chanel as Crime City taking the front, but they've got two blockers on the track. Can't risk any potential failure to reform penalties or anything like that. Gogo Chanel able to spread apart the two blockers, picking up 5 points here for Rainy City.
So a 3-on-2 pack advantage right now. I'm sorry, a 3-on-1 pack advantage in favor of Rainy City on this power jam. That's Frick's Road going to the penalty box.
And fortunately for Crime City, Chutette is now approaching the pack. She is now in the front, but got knocked to the outside and recycled back just as Go-Go Chanel approached. And jam ends with an additional 5 points picked up, a 15-point jam for Rainy City.
That was a nice little attempted apex jump there from Jutette. And we are going to take this opportunity to thank our friends at 888 Helmets, Pads, Wrist Guards. We got you covered. Go to 888.com. That's 888. Hannah Pay is going to start this one in the box, but she is standing. So 10 seconds or fewer for her. Wild, number 12 for Rainy City.
Wild approaching the front of the pack here, almost immediately bursts through in a complete different maneuver from anything else we've seen here today. Wild out and lead.
She got a 90% lead jammer status in the game against Santa Cruz.
Yeah, she was fantastic in that game. Now as Crime City with the triangle in the front trying to hold her down was Dykestalker and below me, but a challenge of the link, no multiplayer block call, able to get Wild through as Hannah Pay with a star stash is also out. Now Rainy City looking to run away a little bit, trying to get that front lane, and we have a race to get to the front.
We've been seeing this all weekend, Sasha. It's the fastest jammer to hit the back of the pack who's ended up in the win column.
And Crime City did a good job, though, of getting into a triangle and actually trying to stop a Rainy City blocker and effectively get a runt on that one.
That's a 4-0 jam in favor of Rainy City. Now at 32 points, Crime City 19, 16 minutes and 38 seconds left in the first period. On the Fast Girl start line for Rainy City, Smack Mamba, and we're going to take a timeout. It's a team timeout being taken by Crime City. It, of course, is an Adam timeout, an Adam Skates timeout. Adam Skates just got a lot more colorful. Go to adamskates.com for more information.
So the timeout freezes the clock at 16 minutes and 31 seconds, and I have to think from Crime City, that's a very smart timeout. Their blockers are starting to pick up a couple more penalties than they would probably like. Dykestalker, in fact, is actually at 3 penalties right now. You can see on the whiteboard here, there's number 53 with a CMP. So
directions, multiplayers, and out of plays aplenty.
Yeah.
I mean, these are the types of penalties that you're going to see when last-ditch efforts come into play to keep jammers behind you. I can already see Rainy City trying to tighten it up. They do have a tendency to have everyone on the track turn around at the same time, and I think they've been fighting those tendencies in these first few jams very successfully. Crime City, meanwhile, they have it locked down. They're just not able to keep all of their blockers on the track when they need them.
And that's going to be the biggest thing, especially in this kind of a game, too, because, you know, you're going to need at least three blockers out there on the track. If you've got two blockers in the penalty box, you're not going to be able to effectively break up those triangles and get some offense out there for your jammer. As Prince Sophia going up against Smack Mamba off the Fast Girl Skate start line, both teams operating with brace two walls here. As Prince Sophia trying to wedge her way through, there was no link to create a multiplayer, but actually maybe there was a link to create a multiplayer as Rainy City losing a blocker to the box.
Both Chuchette and Frick's Road trying to do drawbacks, not successfully, but we do have a penalty being assessed to Menace from Rainy City. Multiplayer call again, Sasha.
As right now, Smack Mamba with one blocker to beat there, got knocked to the outside there by Dykestalker. Chutette did a great job of keeping Smack Mamba in the pack there, as now Prince Sophia with effectively Missy Rascal to go up against, along with Liz Yeatman. Those two are trying to stay within the line of play here, and a forearm penalty is going to send Liz Yeatman into the penalty box. As Prince Sophia picking up an additional 5 points here for Crime City.
I don't know who wasn't sent to the penalty box. Whistles flying. I do know that one person who was sent is going to be Yeatman with that forearm.
So right now, Prince Sophia looking to complete her second scoring pass. Finds room on the inside there. Will complete the pass. 10 points in the jam so far. 3 points now separating these two teams. And Smack Mamba has still not completed the initial. Has removed the helmet cover, stashing it in. Went in to crash the front wall there. It was just a braced one effectively. as now Liz Yeatman coming back in to reform the what Rainy City calls the Triangle of Doom. Fricks Rogue coming to try and break that up as Mac Mamba still being held back. One-on-one by Fricks Rogue on the left side of your screen. Prince Sophia now challenging that brace as Smack Mamba being recycled all the way right back into turn number one, and the jam is going to end. Crime City picking up an additional 4 points. We now have a lead change, Double H.
So a 14-0 jam in favor of Crime City. Now at 33, Rainy City 32, 14 minutes and 16 seconds left in the period. A good time for us to thank Fast Girl Skates. Fast Girl Skates is proud to sponsor the 2016 WFTDA Tournament MVP, and we have to start talking about that because MVP time is fast approaching.
Oh, my goodness, in just 4 hours or so.
Go-Go Chanel on the Fast Girl start line for Rainy City. Curly Har for Crime City.
And Curly Har going through on the outside lane. Nice lane got opened up there by Crime City to get Curly Har through. She's lead jammer.
100% lead jammer status. 3 for 3 so far in this game for Curly Har.
And now on the outside once again there, getting tied up by Missy Rascal, but surviving the hit and coming right through. Curly Har picking up an additional 5 points here. Now on her second scoring pass, Star has been passed to Ruthless Philly here. And Ruthless Philly was sort of playing defense as she got the star, went and tried to stop Curly Har and feed her into the brace.
More forearms being assessed. That is going to be 1 to sexual harassment and 1 to the jammer now of record, Ruthless Philly.
So power jam favoring Curly Har. Going up now is Crime City to try and break up that triangle, or at least prevent there from being a brace to the two wall, as Curly Har going to the outside now, running into number 8 Fisher for Rainy City, but able to get through on the toe stops. Nice pass there by Curly Har.
Standing in the penalty box now is Ruthless Philly.
42 seconds left to go here in the jam. Curly Har going in for her third scoring pass. Gets knocked to the outside and opts to call the jam. I guess to attempt to freeze Ruthless Philly in the box there.
Yeah, it wasn't as fast as it needed to be.
But it was close, just not close enough.
Right. So a 10-0 run in favor of Crime City. Now at 43 points, Rainy City 32.
I get the feeling we're going to see a Rainy City timeout here.
I think
here
that's an excellent observation.
Or at least the next couple seconds, because Rainy City didn't put anybody out there on the track.
So a Rainy City team timeout brought to you by our friends at Adam Skates. Check out the new pilot plate in 7 stunning colors.
I'm kind of curious as to why Rainy City let the clock run down for an additional 29 seconds or so before taking that timeout.
I don't know. I think that clock preservation is pretty important even at this point.
Yeah.
Rainy City, having limited lead jammer success so far. Go-Go Chanel has the highest percentage here so far in the game with 67% lead jammer status. Wild is 50-50 with 2 box trips already in the same jam. Jam number 4, cutting the track penalty in that out-of-play engagement. And as you've mentioned, we've seen a lot of out-of-play engagement from jammers in this particular tournament. Crime City, meanwhile, Curly Har staying very low on the penalty scale, which is really good news for Crime City. She's got no penalties so far. She's 100% lead jammer status. If she continues on that trajectory, she can do really good things for her team in this game. She has the high points on her team right now at 24.
And if I'm not mistaken, she also has, her team has not been scored against while she's out there as well.
Excellent observation. Hannah Pay on the line for Crime City. Wild for Rainy City.
So a track cut called on Wild there as Hannah Pay nudged her out and then rolled back. Very brilliant play there by Hannah Pay to force a power jam for Crime City.
Second cutting the track penalty of the game for Wild. Third all told.
As now Hannah Pay in the pack on her first scoring pass as Crime City now holding back here, trying to basically allow Hannah Pay to break the wall herself. Got nudged to the outside. She's going to have to go all the way back into turn 3.
And you know, that speed is not something you want to give a jammer. If you're able to get to the front of the pack, you need to put on the brakes and slow it down, just like Faye Roberts is trying to do right there. And she's going to be able to draw that cutting the track penalty against Hanapay.
That was super close there because the jammer referee signaled for a no pass, no penalty, but got overruled by the outside pack ref, and an illegal procedure penalty for Wild is going to send her back to the penalty box.
So an illegal reentry for Wild is going to give her four.
Hanapay's penalty time very short here, as we're going to go the full 2 minutes. Hanapay is going to be back on her first scoring pass. Wild has not completed her initial, as she is now back out against, again, an abbreviated penalty is probably what we could say there. Hanapay able to complete the pass after stretching out Rainy City's front wall, as 5 points picked up, as now Wild has completed her initial. 20 seconds left to go in the jam here, as Faye Roberts looking to rejoin the action, getting knocked back and recycled by Below Me. Hanapay coming into the pack, got nudged out on the outside here.
I like the way Fricks Road kind of popped ahead as an advanced offensive scout for her jammer. That's what Crime City's been doing this whole weekend, and it's been successful.
Jam time's out here, as four additional points will be added up for Crime City, two for Rainy City.
So a 9-2 run in Crime City's favor. Now at 52 points, Rainy City 39, 9 minutes and 57 seconds left in the first period. And it's a good time for us to thank our friend at Radar. The new Radar Halo will achieve world-class edging without sacrificing grip. On the fast girl start line for Rainy City, Alex Valentine against Prince Sophia.
As the pack basically started at the pivot line, then rolled back all the way to the jammer line just as the jam started. Both teams operating at full strength. Nobody in the penalty box here. That's about to change as Alex Valentine working her way in, and that is going to be number 9 kicks on her way to the penalty box.
And you know, that was a delayed exit, and I'm wondering why, because she was right near the line of no return, and if you go in a timely manner, you don't have to go all the way around the track.
A ray of sunshine here on Rainy City's day is Alex Valentine, lead jammer for Rainy City. Star has been stashed there by Prince Sophia, as Alex Valentine running her way into a triangle. Both teams effectively employing braced two walls. We've seen a lot of braced two wall work in this tournament, Double H.
And Bruisin' Banshee holding this entire thing together by a thread, and she's trying to delicately decide whether or not she's in position to play some offense, and she believes that she is. So she's going to try to do it, and then drops right back to bridge. It's nice bridging here from Bruisin' Banshee.
Yeah, Alex Valentine got moved to the outside there, which forced the bridge to go through. Valschut was the blocker responsible for sort of tying up Alex Valentine, is right now, again, bridging back. Was Bruisin' Banshee to keep her blockers in play and keep Prince Sophia out, but Alex Valentine really struggling against that four blocker connection there.
Ruthless Philly headed to the penalty box as well, so now only two blockers up front, and Bruisin' Banshee's gonna trust them. Penalty, I like that move.
Yeah, penalty has been called as Rainy City will lose another blocker to the penalty box here as Alex Valentine going up against the wall by herself. Prince Sophia has completed the initial. 5 seconds left to go in the jam. Prince Sophia may not have enough time to get through, as it doesn't matter anyway. Alex Valentine's going to call it.
I think she wasn't quite entirely sure if she was still lead jammer. She had to look around because her bench was saying call it, and she didn't like, look as though she knew it was her at first.
Which bench is saying call it? I don't know if it's mine.
So she was able to do that. I got to give it to Rainy City in this jam. Even with two blockers on the track, their transitions were where they were supposed to be when they were supposed to be there, which is why we had a 3-0 jam in their favor. Now 37 points on the board for Rainy City. Crime City 52.
Pack advantage will favor Crime City here, as Curly Har going out on the outside lane using that pack advantage to her favor. Lead jammer status going to the team from Malma, as Fatal Blonde still trapped at, and she has removed the helmet cover. There was a maneuver there, a fake out by Ruthless Philly to try and get the star pass. Now there's been a successful star pass. Curly Hart has already completed her first scoring pass.
Ruthless Ponies, Ruthless Fillies.
It's so
all
ponies
ruthless.
And fillies, yeah.
They're all ruthless. I'll tell you what's ruthless, though. Curly Har's lead jammer percentage right now, she's still 4-for-4, 33 points to her credit. That was a 9-0 jam in Crime City's favor. 61 now Crime City. Rainy City, 37 with 6 minutes and 20 seconds left.
You would think you wouldn't mix up the names Roasted Pony and Ruthless Philly until you've been here for 15 games.
And then all of the names, just you just say words.
It just all meshes together.
Watermelon.
What?
Topeka. Hennepay, who is jamming now for Crime City. Go-Go Chanel for Rainy City.
It's almost like Jammer Tourette's here, as both teams operating at full strength. Hennepay taking the inside, but gets knocked out in the process. And brilliant awareness there to know that Ruthless Philly was called for an out-of-play engagement. Hennepay out and lead. Now starting her first scoring pass is Go-Go Chanel trying to take the outside lane. Trippy, they did a great job there once again to try and get Go-Go Chanel trapped, but not able to do so. Hennepay has completed first scoring pass, going to call off the jam.
And you know, I liked how Fisher kind of instinctively knew that she should be trying to bridge with the additional teammates of hers in the front and with Crime City in the back. Rainy City's pack awareness here has been right on, but that was a 4-0 jam in Crime City's favor. Their jamming's been on fire. 65 points for them. Rainy City, 37, 5 minutes and 8 seconds left in the first.
A relatively quick-moving first half here. Well, not quick-moving on the track. There's been a lot of grinding
on the
track. I
mean, we've been sitting, so yeah. We are not quickly moving.
It's all quick for us, you know, as Prince Sophia now running into the brace up against Wild, who is running into a similar brace, the inside portion of the brace that we've called the sad place over this tournament. Because, yeah, boy, when you're in there, you feel sad. As Wild now with one blocker to beat here.
She has been assessed lead jammer status.
But Trippy did went back and bridged back to keep Dykestalker in play.
Oh, and there's going to be a penalty assessed for that out-of-play engagement.
Dykestalker on her way to the box has now
4 penalties to her credit, 2 of them an out-of-play engagement.
Star has been passed to Trippy as they are now the jammer for Crime City. Wild with the opportunity to call it off before Trippy makes it a way through. And 4 points picked up here for Crime City.
4 points for Rainy City.
Oh, hey, I messed up
my
cities.
Okay. That's fine.
They're European.
It's still a city. You got it. 4-0 jam in Rainy City's favor. Crime City 65, Rainy City 41, 3 minutes and 52 seconds left on the clock. Curly Har again on the Fast Girl start line. So she has lost lead. So it is telling us now in Ringster that she is 4-for-5, but technically she did get lead 5 times. Let's see if she can do it again. Number 100, Curly Har jamming against Smack Mamba, 48.
Rainy City using their pack advantage to go 4-on-1 against Curly Har as Crime City's pack going 3-on-1 effectively. Curly Har with a great opportunity to split things through as a 4-arm penalty called on Missy Rascal. Curly Har got knocked to the outside briefly by Fisher before a recovery as Menace has to drop back here after a penalty called on a second Rainy City blocker.
Yeah, there was engagement during a no-pack call, so both of these blockers now headed to the penalty box, Fisher and Missy Rascal.
Curly Har working her way into turn number one as Smack Mamba has stashed the star. Curly Har basically trapped in a one-person brace. Ruthless Philly holding in Bruised and Banshee is now Crime City going to play offense after Smack Mamba completes the initial pass.
And another out-of-play engagement going to a Crime City skater that was Valshut.
Yeah, it was indeed Valshut.
The one and only. So again, these are the types of penalties that we're seeing racking up from these blockers, just absolutely desperate to keep these jammers at bay. Go-Go Chanel, number 5 for Rainy City on the line against Hennepay. Number 0347 for Crime City.
2 minutes and 15 seconds left to go here when we start our next jam, as it is 2-on-2 out there on the track in terms of blockers.
It's a couples only jam,
yeah.
Sasha.
Yeah, and there's no room for a third as Go-Go Chanel able to work her way through. Lead jammer for Rainy City. I believe the first time Hennepay has followed through here. I almost had my thoughts mixed up on Hennepay and Curly Har there. No points scored on that jam whatsoever.
We're going to thank our friends at Quick. When you need to roll quick, think quick. Quick bearings, where precision meets performance.
28 points still separating these two teams. We're going to start the next jam. There will be about a minute 25 left on the period clock. Both teams still have their ORs if they decide they want to maybe use one as a timeout after the conclusion of this jam, as long as there's still time on the period clock.
Dykstalker on the line for the first time wearing the star for Crime City in this game. Alex Valentine for Rainy City.
Alex Valentine running up against the wall of Crime City, now folding back. Kicks trying to hold things down along with Trippy. Kicks was the last blocker to go as a multiplayer was called on Curly Har as a blocker. So that is lead jammer status going to Alex Valentine.
Recycling happening at the front in a lovely way here from Rainy City, but they're forced to let Dykstalker go.
And now Alex Valentine on her first scoring pass, calling off the jam with 47 seconds left to go on the period clock. 2 points were picked up by Rainy City.
Crime City 69, Rainy City 43. 38 seconds left on the clock, so plenty of time to have another jam. And on the fast girl start line, we will have number 12, Wild. And there's the fourth penalty that I see now against her. So Rainy City having some trouble with Wild today. Prince Sophia completely clean, no penalties for her on the line for Crime City, and she also has 17 points.
4-on-3 pack advantage favoring Rainy City as Prince Sophia running into a braced three. Haven't seen one of those out of Rainy City in a while, as effectively a split apart inverted triangle to try and hold Wild back, now rotating back into a brace two. Prince Sophia now a double brace two here in the front coming onto the pivot line.
Period. Nice clear on the inside though.
Period time has lapsed as Curly Hoare coming back on as a blocker trying to break up the double brace. Prince Sophia moving the entire Rainy City pack through in between turns one and two is Curly Hoare bridging back to keep her blockers in play. Now breaking things up, a two wall left for Prince Sophia to get through.
That was a nice drawback there from Curly Hoare, but we are going to see some penalties assessed.
That is Liz Eatman with a multiplayer block. It's Wild now.
Another
let go
for Faye Roberts as well, now sitting at five penalties for Rainy City.
And if they lose Faye Roberts, they're losing a major part of their defense here, as whistle called and a low block was called on Kicks as the jam ends with four additional points picked up by Crime City.
So 30 points separating these teams now. Crime City 73, Rainy City 43. I really think that Rainy City's recycling has been on point. Their transitions have been on point. They've been out-jammed in this game. Curly Hoare is having an amazing game. 100% lead jammer status. She's 5-for-5, 37 points to her credit. Hannah Pei has 2 points. Let's see. She's got 18 points to her credit, and Prince Sophia also has 18 points to her credit. Very exciting. On behalf of Rainy City, we've got some mixed stats. Lead jammer status, the high there, 67% is Alex Valentine, 60% Go-Go Chanel. Wild, 43. She's 3-for-7, but the big story here for Wild is four penalties, and one of them an illegal procedure for an illegal reentry.
Yeah, we've seen some illegal reentry penalties this tournament, and for the life of me, I can't understand why.
You know, I think that part of it could also be inexperience, excitement, not the best track awareness. I've seen a few penalties assessed in this tournament so far to teams who for illegal reentry, but I've also seen, and we just saw in this first period, penalties being assessed and blockers leaving the track late. Mm-hmm. For example, we had a penalty assessed right in front of the penalty box and pushing forward all the way past the pivot line. Well, now you've got to go all the way around the track to get to the box. So just that type of awareness isn't as crisp. But again, these teams have played several games this weekend already. They're probably very tired and exhausted. And we have the battle for fifth place, of course. Crime City looking to maintain that. Rainy City looking to improve.
And speaking of breaks, we're going to go ahead and take a break. We'll be back here in about 10 minutes or so with the second half of our game here at the International 2016 Division I Playoffs here in Columbia, South Carolina.
Welcome back to the battle for fifth place. Crime City taking on Rainy City. I'm Devil H here with Sasha Morgan. Hello.
Hi. How are you?
Good. Welcome back. What a battle we have as well. We've got some really great jamming on behalf of Crime City to take a look at some of the data from the first period. Multiple scoring passes being able to get in there from Crime City, whereas Rainy City, not as much. Of course, Wild sitting with four penalties from the first period. A really prolific jammer for Rainy City, who's just been neutralized by these penalties from Crime City.
Yeah, in terms of going out there and getting penalties, it's not beneficial, obviously. One of your top jammers
hashtag
has four.
Going out and getting penalties, not beneficial.
Not good. Hashtag obvious statement. But what I found interesting, we were discussing this during the half, aside from Hannah Pay having two penalties and Wild having four, no other jammers have any penalties.
No, and that's a good sign for both teams. Where Crime City has been able to gain, so they are 73 to 43. That 30-point difference is due to multiple scoring passes within each jam that Crime City has been able to get in. Several jams, in fact, at least five of them, whereas Rainy City's been only able to get in two scoring passes with more points than just one pass. So really good job on behalf of Crime City's jammers. And for the most part, that is due to Curly Whore, Hannah Pay, and Prince Sophia. Dykestalker, of course, had one jam of her own. But Curly Whore has had a great game, 5 for 5 on lead jammer status, 100% lead jammer status, of course, 37 points and a 37-point differential, which means no one has scored when she's been on the track with the jammer star.
Yeah, that's obviously a great statistic for your jammer to have. If you know, you can go out there, nobody scored while she's out there. A fantastic way to sort of build up that confidence. But
and we've been talking about sad places all weekend. The penalty board is a little bit of a sad place right now as well. Faye Roberts at the top there, number 11 for Rainy City, sitting on 6 penalties for the first period. Mm-hmm. And, of course, right underneath her, Wilds, number 12, is going to be the jammer on the track. She's got 4 penalties. One of them, we were talking about the last one, an illegal procedure for an illegal reentry. So I think it's just one of those situations where the teams are tired. They haven't had a ton of playoff experience. I know Crime City certainly does and is playing that way, the more experienced team in this game so far. But Rainy City definitely looking to pull it together in this second period.
Yeah, in terms of total accumulation, I believe you had mentioned that it's 23 for Crime City and 24 for Rainy City overall.
On behalf of penalties, yes. Yeah. So it's fairly even in number, but really the two players on behalf of Rainy City with the lion's share of those is Faye Roberts and Wild.
So we're about to resume action here as
does
a team
Hannah
timeout.
Does Hannah not know that she does not have her jammer star?
Well, the Crime City called a team timeout, I believe, immediately at the start of the half.
Fascinating. Okay. We have a timeout. It is not being attributed to a team currently, but it is a timeout. And now Hannah Pay has been handed the star.
What a confusing start to the second half here. Hannah Pay now has the star on her helmet, as does Wild. Waiting to see if I saw off screen that the Crime City bench made the timeout signal with their hands, so I don't know
if it'll be credited to them. It doesn't look like it is.
If it isn't, they looked out pretty good.
Yeah, they really did. Oh, excellent news from Talk to WFTDA. At the Swedish Champs this summer, Hannah Pay made a 40-point jam with the other jammer never making an initial pass.
And yeah, that was a timeout for Crime City. So Crime City forced to use one of their timeouts because helmet covers were not in play.
And, of course, our team timeout is brought to you by Adam Skates, our friends at Adam Skates, offering Color Falcon plates.
Well, we saw in the game against Atlanta that Crime City had a lot of timeout and time management issues here. No time management issues for Wild. She burst straight through and lead for Rainy City, as both teams with two blockers out there now rushing to try and get blockers out of the box and prevent scoring from occurring. Once again, you're effectively watching a race with blockers here, as Crime City now trying to defend. Rainy City now calling off the jam before any, I don't believe any points were scored there on either side. Wow.
So, it was a nice penalty kill.
It was like we were watching things moving in fast forward, if you remember the VCR days.
I remember the VCR days. I also remember the early Derby days, and it felt a whole lot like 2010. Crime City fielding Prince Sophia, number 3. Rainy City, Go-Go Chanel, number 5. And we are 3-on-3 in the pack, so taking the back line is Crime City.
Yeah, the racing was able to get one blocker out for each side. Faye Roberts is about to rejoin the action. She was sitting in the box as now Prince Sophia was trying to work through on the inside lane, but a nice outside lane got opened up by Go-Go Chanel. Dykstalker trying to hold her back down as Go-Go Chanel will get out and through. And Prince Sophia tied up for a brief moment. That's going to give her about a third of a track length for Go-Go Chanel to work.
Rainy City trying to slow the pack down. That's one thing they haven't been able to do from the first period. And they did it really well there, Sasha.
As Go-Go Chanel calling off the jam, that will make 4 points for Rainy City, 73-47 with 28 minutes left to go here.
So back on the line for Crime City, Curly Har. And she is wearing the star. Number 100 is her number. Alex Valentine, number 666 for Rainy City on the Fast Girl start line.
I'm sure Crime City's bench can agree that your jammer having the star at the start of the jam is probably
the best thing.
That's the best way to go
for your jammer.
Both teams starting at full strength here. I wonder how long that'll last. Is a good hit there by Fisher to try and tie up. Curly Hoare got knocked to the outside, did Fisher. Now Curly Hoare with one or two blockers to beat in the front is Fisher getting moved to the outside, and Bruise and Banshee along with Missy Rascal forming that braced wall as Curly Hoare getting pushed to the inside.
A back block being assessed in here to Bruise and Banshee.
Yeah, because Curly Hoare had moved to the outside and the impact was to the back of Curly Hoare. So now Trippy coming up to try and assist their jammer as Ruthless Philly knocked out Curly Hoare and jumped back to the pivot line, I should say.
And now only two blockers deep is Rainy City with Fisher going to the box for a direction.
So the penalties just keep on a rolling here as Alex Valentine spreading out the Crime City pack. Lead jammer status going to her as now Curly Hoare is out. Alex Valentine now approaching the back of the pack. Crime City took the front as quickly as they could. Now Rainy City looking to split things up to get a lane for Alex Valentine to score points. She has already completed. Yep, she completes the scoring pass right there. That should be four. And it will indeed be 4 points, Double H.
Alex Valentine completing most of that pass backwards, trying to keep her opposing jammer in view. Coach Marone on Twitter says, I felt like I was watching Oli 3 versus Oli 6. Or Oli
in general.
The WFTDA championships.
Yeah.
They were an extremely fast team to keep up with. Number 38, Faye Tao Blonde on the line for Rainy City, but we are going to see a team timeout.
No, Crime City's using their official review. Rainy City's using
it. It is now turning into an official review for Rainy City.
Official reviews all over the place.
And our official review is brought to us by our friends at Adam Skates. Adam Skates, hashtag color me Adam. All right, so we do have two jammers on the track when we restart this jam. Let's see if that changes at all with this official review.
Right now you see on the screen, you did see for a brief moment, Mick Swagger out there communicating what the official review would be about on behalf of Rainy City. Mick Swagger is the A for them. As Pantychrist listening intently. Kind of curious as to what would be reviewed here, because I didn't see anything too terribly egregious from Rainy City that would have needed to be overturned or maybe a penalty that should have been assessed.
Yeah, it looks like Mick Swagger is asking for something perhaps that occurred against her jammer, but we'll find out from the Pantychrist.
He has called for an official review. They would like a track cut penalty assessed to the Crime City jammer just out of turn one, both hands out, and stood up in bounds, completing the cut. The officials will review.
I believe, Double H, that was on the when Curly Hoare was knocked out and got the back block pulled against her.
Right at turn one on the inside.
Yeah.
We shall see. Lots of great watch parties happening on Twitter, though,
Sasha. I love those watch parties. Tell me more about them.
Scream Queen and Royal City. I think I might have a friend or two with that league.
Allegedly.
Sorry, everyone else. Royal City has the best watch party today. I'm going to agree with that. We do not have a pool here at the venue.
Not even an inflatable hot tub.
No, and the inflatable couch is leaking.
Somebody get some duct tape to fix that up. Here's the penalty board, and for those of you at home who like to keep track of these things.
And
number nine.
Not a ton of penalties being added so far. We're just 4 minutes into the second period. The score, Crime City 73, Rainy City 51. That was a 4-0 jam in favor of Rainy City before they called this official review.
Kicks on the side has a PCL, which is good. You don't want a PCL on the board. You want one in your knee. That was the worst joke I could have come up with today.
Yeah.
Not too many derby players have PCLs these days.
I was trying to be kind. But we've been watching Sissy Splasek hobble around all weekend.
Technically, that's her meniscus.
I know. But still, it hurts. It hurts me.
We just know our future is going to have a knee surgeries for all of us.
Now, if Rainy City is able to get this penalty against Curly Hara, it works out well in their favor. She has yet to go to the penalty box.
Well, as a jammer, she has.
As a jammer. So 37 points to her credit still in this game. 83% lead jammer status for her. So it would be a huge feat if Rainy City were able to accomplish this.
Yeah, Curly Hart was staffed as a blocker during the first half, picked up a multiplayer and an out-of-play engagement.
Yeah, so Terabyte on Twitter is underscoring that with all caps.
We can't say most of that tweet.
Exactly. And Panty Christ.
The Crime City jammer did stand up in bounds, completing the cut before stepping out to recycle herself. The call will be assessed, and Rainy City will retain their official review. Thank you.
Yep, and that is a big win for Rainy City.
A raucous cheer from a good portion of the crowd here.
And so on the Fast Girl start line will be number 12, Wild. Again, Wild sitting on 4 penalties of her own. So with 26 minutes and 1 second left to go in this game, she must stay clean.
Rainy City's blockers trying to thread themselves through to get a lane open for Wild. They've done a great job so far. One blocker to beat was Trippy, and Wild is through. Lead jammer, Rainy City.
Nice job from Rainy City. They are goading at the back from Frick's Road, preventing her from going anywhere.
Wild get trapped behind the behind that wall, but Rainy City now dropping back, allowing passive offense to happen. That is going to be a completed scoring pass. 5 points picked up. You do not see it on the screen, but Curly Hart is standing, and the penalty is now over. She will be on her initial pass when she comes out.
Rainy City, the back line is ready for her, but not ready to hold her.
You have to think Curly Hart might be thinking, you're trying to penalize me, you will suffer for it, in a much more Swedish voice than me.
And perhaps not even in English.
That was what I was thinking.
So an 8-0 jam there in Rainy City's favor. And again, what we were seeing in the first period is very few multiple scoring passes within a jam for Rainy City. That's what they're going to need to continue. So an 8-0 jam in their favor. Now Rainy City 59, Crime City 73.
Next jam getting lined up here on the Fast Girl Skate start line will be that'll be Fatal Blonde going up against Hannah Pei. Only a third jamming appearance for Fatal Blonde on the day so far, as Hannah Pei trying to take the outside lane got knocked out there by Bruising Banshee. Fatal Blonde running directly into a 4 brace.
I gotta say, Bulomi has been owning these lines all weekend.
Oh yeah.
And she's been so impressive.
As Fatal Blonde took the outside lane, Hannah Pei found a little bit of purchase on the inside, and now Hannah Pei trying to nudge Fatal Blonde back out and attempt to put her out as the pack racing up behind her. You do not see it on the screen.
Is she trying to get the baby eaten?
Yeah, I believe she was, because if she had done that, that would have forced the call off. And Fatal Blonde knocked into the crowd. She's going to have to re-enter behind the pack. Hannah Pei got trapped up. No, a 4-arm penalty for Hannah Pei. So it's a power jam, Rainy City.
I have not seen a baby successfully eaten in quite some time, Sasha. And now there's going to be a blocking with the head penalty assessed to Fatal Blonde.
So we are going to go the full 2 minutes, 55 seconds left to go here as Fatal Blonde just now taking a seat with 50 seconds left to go in the jam. Here comes Hannah Pay. And Rainy City now trying to prevent or trying to form up a wall, but Crime City splitting things up. No pass, no penalty on the reentry there for Hannah Pay. 3 points were picked up. As Fatal Blonde is now out, you'll see both jammers approaching the back of the pack here shortly, and the pack starting to speed up. Hannah Pay approaching, coming into turn number one, but Rainy City has that front wall.
And Crime City with the back, but full four in the back.
Fisher's had to drop back in order to bridge to keep her front blockers in play. 5 points picked up by Rainy City as Hannah Pay successfully stretched out the pack. Now Fatal Blonde looking to the outside lane, getting, well, we just saw Missy Rascal drill Hannah Pay in the process.
What I really liked in that last pass was Rainy City dropping back to play that offense. They did it cleanly. We do have a lot of direction calls in this game so far. I know that's something that is really easy to happen when you're performing offense from the front, going backwards. They did a nice job staying clean there. On the Fast Girl start line for Rainy City, number 5, Go-Go Chanel. Prince Sophia, number 3, no penalties in this game so far for her. And we're going to take an official timeout to clean up another spill. I'm not entirely sure if it's coming from the ceiling or if that was due in part to the jammer.
I believe it was a spill beverage. I'm not 100% sure, but there were some beverages on that track area when Fatal Blonde got knocked out. We got a thumbs up there from our track crew.
So we will have Prince Sophia and Go-Go Chanel. We're going to take another official timeout for a moment. Prince Sophia with a 25% lead jammer status, although I'm fairly certain one of those might. Nope, they no lost leads actually. They're 18 points and a differential of positive 3. So Curly Horse still really on top here for Crime City in terms of jamming. And number 5, Go-Go Chanel, 50% lead jammer status for her, no penalties. And a positive differential of 9 with 23 points in the game so far.
So clock still frozen at 22 minutes and 11 seconds here as we will basically be on hold for a couple of moments. And now looks like PH Diva is skating over to the scorekeepers to confirm points. So official timeout appears to be to confirm points scored.
And the last jam was 9-4 in favor of Crime City. We'll see if that changes. All 5 jams that have been completed so far. Oh, and points being removed from Rainy City. So all 5 jams, though, had been a lead jammer status for Rainy City. But that's a loss of 4 points. So a 9-0 jam that last one in Crime City's favor.
Mick Swagger not happy about points being taken away here. Is Pantychrist now having a discussion with Mick Swagger to explain why those points were removed. Mick Swagger is going out
Mick
to
Swagger
talk to the jammer referee.
Would like to talk to PH Diva. So we're still on an official timeout, though it's not a team timeout and it's not an official review. PH Diva.
You know, I think what may have happened was Fatal Blonde, she had gotten out, she had gotten lead, then got reabsorbed into the pack, then got penalized. So the question is, did she, even though she got lead, did she fully complete the initial pass? Mm-hmm. Because if she came out of the box without that initial pass completed, she would have started it right back over again, even though she got lead, because she never left the engagement zone.
Well, according to PH Diva, she was reabsorbed. So she was eaten successfully.
So that means she was not on a scoring pass.
Correct.
Yeah, not on a scoring pass. So Rainy City scores no points. Prince Sophia now jamming against Go-Go Chanel after that little bit of confusion has been resolved. Both teams operating at full strength here as Crime City sitting below me to try and open up a lane for Prince Sophia, or at least break up the brace 3. Prince Sophia pushing against that brace 2 as one blocker, Liz Yeatman, having to drop back to keep an eye on below me.
I like that, though.
Yeah.
I like what she's able to accomplish.
Yeah, because what she's doing is effectively trying to keep below me from going and splitting things up, just like she has done right here. And a whistle has been called on Dykestalker, who is going to be on her way to the penalty box for a forearm penalty.
And an additional penalty, a forearm being assessed.
That was to Chuchette.
Yeah.
And now lead jammer status going to Go-Go Chanel. A huge opportunity here for Rainy City to try and get those points back on the board. Prince Sophia has stashed the star. She has escaped the pack as now Go-Go Chanel approaching on the right-hand side, coming out on the outside lane. That is going to be a completed initial pass. 4 points picked up. Prince Sophia approaching the back of the pack. You'll see her come on your screen shortly.
Here's Rainy City with a nice slowdown. It's a 4-2 pack advantage in their favor.
Go-Go Chanel not calling the jam off here as Prince Sophia had a nice lane on the inside.
Yeah, that was Sister Stitch with the clear on the inside.
So you've got to think, I've got to think that Go-Go Chanel was going to trust her blockers to try and hold with the 4-2 advantage, and Sister Stitch opened that lane up.
I agree with that. 8-4 in favor of Rainy City. Crime City is at 86 points. Rainy City 67, 20 minutes and 21 seconds left in the second period. Rainy City Roller Derby on Talk to WFTDA's hashtag. I think we are actually having the best viewing party in the Thunderdome. Rainy City Roller Derby on the Fast Girl start line. Alex Valentine for them against Curly Horror for Crime City.
Both teams again operating at full strength as a battle royal breaks out between the pivot line and the jammer line. Alex Valentine sent to the outside there by Kicks is below me. Drop back to force the recycle. Curly Horror now going up against a double brace as Trippy going up to try and break things up for their jammer. Curly Horror going onto the outside lane, got knocked to the outside, but trying to get past, got the hips past at least.
Alex Valentine headed to the penalty box for a cutting the track penalty. This will be a power jam, Curly Horror.
She's got to get out of the pack first to get complete that initial and get that lead jammer status. She has finally done so as Alex Valentine is just now taking a seat. So Curly Horror approaching the pack. You'll see her come on the right-hand side of your screen there.
And this is the first lead jammer status in this period for Crime City.
Curly Horror getting, absorbing the hit from Ruthless Philly. 5 points will be picked up here from Crime City as Crime City now taking the back of the pack. Below me, going back to keep bridged. They're going to effectively force Alex Valentine to come back. That's why they're positioned the way they are, because Alex Valentine's penalty is over. Curly Horror now going up against the double race, and here comes Below Me to help things out.
And you see the way Curly Horror is opening herself up to look for her offense. That's what you want to do. You're wedging that shoulder in there, getting the other one back so you can turn around fully and take that O.
Oh, yeah. As Curly Horror going onto the inside lane now, trying to find a lane, but Missy Rascal shuts things down, as does Bruising Banshee. Vivian Lethal is trying to help with the brace with a great takeout there and point it back. That was great nonverbal communication by Vivian Lethal.
And a nice job from both of these teams slowing things down, almost getting back on the track for a cutting call.
We did.
With Ruthless Philly.
Yeah, we did have a star pass to Ruthless Philly here, as now Ruthless Philly is out. Curly Horror in control, if she wants to call it. With 3 seconds left, it may not even matter here. And it doesn't, as jam times out. An additional 5 points picked. Well, no, 4 points picked up. No, 5 points picked up. 4 or 5, who knows? 10 points overall.
Some points.
You're going to have to do the math on your own, everybody.
Crime City, 10-0 on that jam. Now at 96 points. Rainy City, 67. 17 minutes and 46 seconds. Enough time for us to thank our friends at 5-on-5 Magazine, Fast Girl Skates, and Triple Eight.
29 points separating these two teams with 17 and a half minutes left to go. Hannah Pay jamming against Wild for their respective squadrons. As Hannah Pay trying to find the inside lane, but almost got blocked by her own brace there, as they were trying to control Wild.
There's going to be a high block being assessed to Crime City's pivot. That is Trippy. They're going to the penalty box.
And Wild finding a nice little lane on the inside, able to get through. Lead jammer status going to Rainy City as Hannah Pay knocked to the outside by Faye Roberts. Faye Roberts living on the edge there with 6 penalties.
Aren't we all living on the edge?
Man, can't help yourself from falling.
Speaking of living on the edge, Hannah Pay on the outside edge.
And Wild getting spun around here, coming into turn number 4. Going to go ahead and call off the jam before any damage can be done from Crime City. 5 points scored by Rainy City.
Yeah, I think time is of the essence right now for Rainy City. They're going to want to get as many points as they can and call it to reset for the next one. That was a 5-0 jam in their favor, now at 72 points to Crime City's 96, 16 minutes and 26 seconds on the clock. Go-Go Chanel, number 5 for Rainy City on the line. Prince Sophia, number 3 for Crime City.
If you're just joining us, Crime City in the purple, Rainy City in the white. As whistle sounds here, a pack advantage favoring Rainy City 4-on-3 as Rainy City now great maneuvering by the pivot, Ruthless Philly, to get her brace on that wall. And now Trippy coming in again to help their jammer as Prince Sophia trying to work a small little lane on the out on the inside. And Ruthless Philly tying that lane right back up, Double H.
Yeah, and I think Trippy realizing they need to be able to play offense and then jump back to bridge as quickly as possible because this pack is so fluid right now.
Go-Go Chanel recycled all the way back into turn number 1 here is Prince Sophia running into basically what looks like an inverted brace, so to speak, because Rainy City's blockers were facing Prince Sophia. Penalty is going to be called on a Rainy City blocker. That is Bruising Banshee on her way to the box.
And that's a direction of gameplay.
Fricks Road on her way to the box as well as Prince Sophia is out and lead. Now Prince Sophia approaching the back of the pack as a lot of recycling making the pack rather sparse for Rainy City. Completion of the scoring pass, 5 points picked up. Crime City now over the 100 mark.
The star was stashed by an exhausted Go-Go Chanel, who is now putting it back on. And the pack taking off, Sasha.
Rainy City trying to get to the front of the pack and spring their jammer as Bruising Banshee is standing in the box, trying to basically spread things out. Prince Sophia with the option to call it, but this works in her favor as well because she could just bleed some time off the clock.
And she's doing exactly that. Go-Go Chanel looking totally winded, about half a track behind Prince Sophia.
Chutet has now rejoined the action as Rainy City's box is empty. Bruising Banshee still in the box waiting to go.
Crime City, nice work from Dykestalker to peel off a blocker as a point at the back.
So Ruthless Philly was passed there and that got the ghost point that was represented by Bruising Banshee. 2 points picked up to make it 7 in the jam for Crime City.
The WFTDA would like to thank our friends at Derby City Skates, Pop-Up Skates, and Rose City Rollers for their assistance this weekend. Crime City with 30 points and Rainy City with 39 just in this period, bringing them to a total of Crime City 103, Rainy City 72.
Curly Har going up against Fatal Blonde, and Curly Har with a great move to the inside. Lead jammer status going to Crime City as Fatal Blonde being recycled back by Kicks. Curly Horror now approaching the back of the pack, perhaps the first jammer lap point we've seen here. And now Curly Horror bursting through a two wall in the front, challenged length. Rainy City's blockers didn't want to go out on a multiplayer, especially not Faye Roberts. 5 points picked up for Crime City. Sexual harassment on her way to the box for Crime City as Curly Horror downed in between turns 2 and 3. Now back up, both jammers working up against brace two walls. And on her toe stops was Curly Horror before getting recycled back now.
And I just love the way Rainy City was able to take her speed away as she came around on her last scoring pass. She really counts on that speed because that's how she's able to get a run. And she's decided she's had enough.
Well, you know, that's going to bleed an additional 30 seconds off the clock here. 8 points picked up, takes it to 111-72.
78% lead jammer status for her, for Curly Horror, in this game with the high for her team, 55 points. But now on the line for Crime City, Hannah Pei. And Hannah Pei with 27 points of her own in this game. Wild, number 12 for Rainy City, with 32 points in this game.
Back advantage will favor Rainy City. Here is Crime City shutting down the inside lane as Bruising Banshee ducking back to recycle Hannah Pei back to the jammer line. Now a sexual harassment coming back in to break up that brace, getting Fisher split out. Fisher rejoining with Ruthless Philly towards the pivot line as Rainy City holding onto their brace right now. Recycle back as Fisher going way, way back to get Hannah Pei back. Wild now looking to the outside lane, trying to find something on the inside, but that gets actually stopped up by her own blockers, Double H.
Yeah, and I think Bruise and Banshee was in the right place at the right time to provide some defense on the inside line, but not that moment. Hannah Pei, lead jammer, Crime City.
Hannah Pei now speeding her way to the back of the pack. She'll be approaching here in just a quick moment. There she is, running directly into the back of Fisher. If that's not a back block, I don't know what is.
Oh, Hannah Pei not happy about that at all. Headed to the penalty box.
Unless she's frustrated with herself, she has no reason to be unhappy about that call. That was a clear back block. As Wild now eligible to score, we will go the full 2 minutes.
Rainy City holding sexual harassment at the back, goading her, trying to keep the pack where they wanted and get some points.
Wild now trying to get things split up here against Schutzett as her blockers looking to split apart the brace. This is exactly what Rainy City needs to do in a situation like this. Now dropping back, they had a run to bridge.
Again, Rainy City needing to put points on multiple scoring passes, not able to fully execute here on this power jam. So now Hannah Pei back on the track.
4-on-3 here as the pivot on her way to the penalty box. That is below me. And Wild looking to try and find some lane on the outside here. 8 seconds left to go in the jam as Schutzett trying to hold things down with sexual harassment and Dykstalker. Schutzett now dropping back to bridge as the jam will time out. 3 points picked up on the scoring pass by Crime City. An additional 5 should go up for Rainy City.
So a 10-3 jam in favor of Rainy City. Getting those multiple scoring passes in is what they need to do, but Crime City is just shutting them down. Crime City now 114 points, Rainy City 82. 9 minutes and 55 seconds left in the game on the Fast Girl start line for Rainy City. Number 666, Alex Valentine for Crime City, Prince Sophia, but a timeout.
This is an official review.
Taken.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Crime City wanting an official review here. This is an Adam Skates official review.
This is an Adam Skates official review.
It is
Adam
indeed.
Skates, check out the new pilot plate in 7 stunning colors. Go to adamskates.com for more information. On Twitter, Coach Marone asking, how did Mick Swagger end up with Rainy City? Well, they met, they liked each other, and she decided that she really wanted to help them out. And, you know, she's over here for a few events that you may have heard of called Division I Playoffs. So she is... done a good amount of coaching in her day and is really excited to be working with Rainy City this season
And you know, with technology, there is such a thing as remote coaching as well, where you can send your coaching plans and then follow along with, like, FaceTime or Google Hangout or something along those lines by watching the practice in that format.
You know, you can announce games that way as well. You don't even have to leave your living room.
I wouldn't recommend it. There's way too much delay.
The Panty Christ.
Well, helps this tournament.
Crime City is calling for an official review. They would like a destroying the pack penalty called on Rainy City during Rainy City's power jam. Mm.
And so Crime City did win their last official review.
That was in the first half. Mm-hmm. So if they win this, they will get a second one. As the clock frozen at 9:47. There are many instances where that pack could have been destroyed. And so,
Yeah, I think that I've seen a couple instances where it's come pretty close to what I would have called the destruction of gameplay.
Mm-hmm.
But from the official's perspective, I think everything held together relatively well. So I'm curious to see how this is going to play out for them. You know, it's the official reviews in this capacity, it's really hard because if you're not there calling it in the moment, it's so hard to go back and say, well, what did you see? Well, what did you see? Well, what did you see? And so I'm really curious to see if this is going to get overturned. I'm not thinking it is.
But in another way, too, it's also a nice stoppage of the clock.
Oh, it sure is. It sure is. And by actually coming up with something to review, you're guaranteeing that it's going to give you more than a minute.
Yeah, because there were, you and I mentioned, there were a couple instances where it could have been destruction.
Mm-hmm.
So not only are you buying at least 2.5 minutes now to rest your jammers because... if Crime City uses basically a 3-jammer rotation, you also may get Rainy City's blockers out on something and get that review back.
And you got an extra maybe 2 minutes out of the deal as well.
Yeah.
So Crime City 114 points, Rainy City 82. It was a 10-3 jam, I should say, in that last Jam, courtesy of Rainy City.
Let's go down to the Panty Christ with the decision, which I think we know what it is.
After review, White 8 did destroy the pack, creating a no-pack situation. A penalty will be assessed, and Crime City will retain their official review.
All right.
So Crime City's bench coach did the finger guns in the process, then jumped up and down as she left the track, screaming, "We won, we won." So that's why I had the feeling that something good had happened.
I'm really impressed. I do really enjoy seeing official reviews that are thought about and discussed, and it turns out that the team actually is able to see something that happened and get the call corrected, and I think the officials are really excited about getting that call right.
And somewhere, Andy Marone is smiling.
Probably Ohio.
That would be my guess. Prince Sophia up against Alex Valentine on the Fast Girl Skate start line. Both teams at even strength, 3-on-3. Both teams, why not throw triangle braces out there? Somebody's going to get called out for a penalty in the process. Not yet sure who that would have been. Or maybe I just heard a whistle from somewhere.
It might have been waved off. I don't know.
Who knows at this point? We hear whistles all day. They
in
just start
sleep.
To ring in your head.
I hear whistles in my sleep.
So Alex Valentine with one blocker to beat in the front. Trippy trying their best to hold things back as Valschut tried to constrain. Alex Valentine was not able to do so. Lee Jammerstadt is going to Rainy City.
And the star being passed to the pivot below me for Crime City.
Faye Roberts tried to recycle there, not seen on the screen as Alex Valentine.
But it is an illegal star pass, and she's going to get an out-of-play call.
Interesting.
But she still has the star, which does not belong to her. So.
And she left the box to throw the helmet cover on the track. I don't know if we caught that. 5 points
yes.
are picked up, so that would be an illegal procedure.
And the NSO in the box is alerting her to that fact.
So Bellomi just got a second penalty tacked on for leaving the box to throw the helmet cover onto the track. Rainy City, I used this joke earlier, it's a huge ray of sunshine because Bellomi's going to foul out. That was her seventh.
All right, so a big stroke of luck for Rainy City. That is 10 points into this jam already. Now picking the helmet cover up off of the track is Prince Sophia.
So initial pass has been completed. Rainy City's already put 14 points on the board. Crime City trying their best to get themselves organized as Rainy City now looking to split them apart. Alex Valentine approaching the back of the pack as Prince Sophia eligible to score. The initial was completed now. Alex Valentine choosing to run it.
Poor below me coming out of the penalty box and forced to the side by the NSO's penalty wranglers. She's not sure what to do, and they're saying, well, you're fouled out. You're not going back on the track.
So 4 points were picked up there by Rainy City, 117 to 100. And Double H, what a mental lapse, I have to say, by below me.
I think it's one of those things that if you're a pivot and you receive the star, mm-hmm. It's extremely confusing because a lot of the penalties favor the jammer, right?
They really
do. The illegal procedure penalties can fall on the jammer. And so when you're a pivot and you see that out of play, for a moment you have to stop and say, wait, why? Because you're caught between two worlds, Sasha. A pivot with the star in your hand. You're caught between two worlds. Who are you?
And then
it's an identity crisis. And at any given second, you have to know who you are. And so it is being explained to her now as she is being escorted from the track. And then, even more confusing, with DJ Jazzy Ref trying to tell her that she needs to remove the star and get it off her helmet cover, mm-hmm. She wasn't sure exactly how to do that. It's probably maybe something she's never had to do before, but she did leave the box, and that was the illegal procedure that fouled her out. Caught between two worlds. Are you a pivot or are you a jammer? And somehow you're neither.
Truly the definition of between a rock and a hard place, I would say.
Oh, that was exciting. It led us to a score of Rainy City 101, Crime City 117.
So an additional point was picked up here. Rainy City will trail by 16. I think now's the time for all of us to take a big deep breath in and a big deep breath out.
By deep breath, you mean drink some more coffee.
Well, you can do that if you wish.
Absolutely.
You do that while I'll encourage the breathing techniques for all of our friends at home. Breathe in and breathe out. We're still in the official timeout here for clarification purposes. 16 points will separate these two teams. Clock frozen at 7 minutes and 26 seconds. This game's pretty much had everything. I mean, we've had star passes. We've had foul outs. We've had gigantic hits. We've had braces. We've had sad places. We've had everything.
And we're about to have 7 minutes and 26 seconds more of it with Curly Horror and Wild jamming.
Wild now looking to try and find an outside lane. Curly Horror saw a brief lane on the inside, got shut down by, quite frankly, the entire Rainy City pack. As Wild looking for the outside, Curly Horror found the outside from got around Missy Rascal. Lead jammer going to Crime City in a very important time for them to gain that lead.
And she's got a 43-point positive differential for her team and 55 total points to her credit.
As Curly Horror getting knocked out by Missy Rascal, having to recycle back here as Ruthless Philly brought her back, and jam gets called off. 3 points will be picked up by Rainy City.
This is a good time for us to thank our friends at Moda Skates, Roll Line, Bruce Skate News, Double Threat Skates, and Cone Law Offices. Thank you from the WFTDA and Columbia Quad Squad for your support of this weekend's events. Crime City 120, Rainy City 101, 6 minutes and 24 seconds.
Should have joined me in the breathing exercise, Double H.
The coffee really helped, though.
As Gogo Chanel going up against Hannah Pei, both teams at full strength, nobody in the penalty box, as Hannah Pei trying to tiptoe her way and wedge a hole in the brace. Now Hannah Pei going to the inside, Rainy City peeling off one blocker to shut that lane down, as now Gogo Chanel tried to find that lane, got shut down by Shutet and Kicks.
Big hit there from Vivian Lethal that was totally legal and lethal.
Now everybody's just all bunched up in a corner, a gigantic sad place, I guess is the best way we could phrase it.
Turn two is just one giant sad place right now.
Especially now the inflatable couch seems to be sinking. As Gogo Chanel with one blocker to beat in the front, it's Trippy. Trippy doing their best to hold back Gogo Chanel for as long as they possibly can. Eventually gets moved out of play, and Gogo Chanel lead jammer for Rainy City after 52 seconds in the jam.
I like the way Rainy City's reforming, but they've got a lot of backwards blocking happening right here.
Is now Gogo Chanel on the first scoring pass, gets knocked to the inside and spun
Gogo
back
Chanel
around.
Gogo Chanel just rolled her eyes as she was taken to the infield.
Rolled her eyes with the head there, just a complete maneuver there. As Gogo Chanel running into the brace, trying to dig her way through.
That is the sad place. People have been asking us all weekend long, what do you mean? That. The look on her face as she eyes up her pivot, not able to help her pivot menace all the way at turn three.
Hannah Pei has still not completed the initial as Trippy bridging back to keep their pack in play. Gogo Chanel looking for some maneuvering to get past Kicks, and a big hit by Menace to open up a small little lane, but it got Hannah Pei through. 8 seconds left to go. Will there be enough time for Gogo Chanel to complete the pass?
Mick Swagger calling for a call off, and that was able to happen. 4-0 jam in Rainy City's favor. 105 points to Crime City's 120, 4 minutes and 12 seconds left on the clock. They've got 2 team timeouts to their credit, Rainy City. 1 official review. Crime City's got 1 team timeout and 1 official review.
A correction on the score there. 1 point came off, so it's 3 points there. We're back to 16 points, Double H.
On the Fast Girls start line, Alex Valentine and Curly Horror.
4-on-3 pack advantage favoring Rainy City as Curly Horror found a nice lane that got opened up just barely on the inside by Rainy City.
You know, she's so patiently waiting for those moments, and it's split seconds. She's just able to grab them.
And Alex Valentine got hit coming into the turn by Fricks Road as Curly Horde now in scoring, picking up points on a scoring pass. Out of play penalty is going to send Missy Rascal to the box, and the pivot, Dyke Stalker for Crime City, also in the box. She'll be joined there by Shutet. What the heck? Let's put everybody in the penalty box while we're thinking about it.
But the helmet cover comes off of Alex Valentine as she's able to make it through on her initial.
Curly Horror has completed the scoring pass, 4 points picked up, and Curly Horror running the jam just briefly, getting enough time to call off.
And this is where Rainy City's getting beat here. Multiple scoring passes able to get in there from Curly Hoare, who's got 67 points in this game to her credit with an awesome lead jammer percentage of 82. And I think one of those may have been a loss lead on a box trip. 55-point positive differential in her favor. She's just been the workhorse here in this game for Crime City.
Coming up next as we move into jam number 16, 2.5 minutes left on the clock as Wild going up against Hanapay. Rainy City tried the rollback. Menace briefly lost her footing but bounced right back up and got the pack able to recycle Hanapay to the back. Wild now trying to get through on the inside. Managed to avoid what was a high impact hug effectively. Lead jammer status going to Rainy City, but Hanapay is chasing right behind her as now a race has taken off in the pack.
Faye Roberts leading the charge for Rainy City to get to the front. She's got six penalties in this game and has done a great job staying clean in the second period.
Again, we have a full-on pack race as Rainy City calling it off.
That was the right call. You do not have the time to waste. Now is the time for Rainy City to take a team timeout.
And they are not doing so quite yet. They've got two team timeouts and the official review, so plenty of clock stoppages are available. As now Mick Swagger coming to the inside. Lineup clock is still moving 10 seconds before a jam will start. And
I'm not sure why Mick Swagger was asking her for a team timeout when the clock got to a certain time. You want every second you can have. And this is an Adam Skates team timeout for Rainy City. Adam Skates just got a lot more colorful. AdamSkates.com. Well, Coach Marin on Twitter agrees with me, and he says Rainy needs to start using those stoppages. I'm not entirely sure why Swagger allowed that much time to lapse.
There was about 23 or 24 seconds that came off the lineup clock, and they had an additional timeout plus the OR. So, I don't know why the delay there. Unless you wanted to get an additional bit of time to calm down her pack, maybe calm down her bench.
I think we wanted additional time to thank some of our friends who have helped us this weekend. Derby Central, Roller Con, Spank Alley, Kaya, and S1. Thank you so much for the support of this tournament and our WFTDA Division I playoffs. In addition to our friends at Fast Girl Skates, who is proud to sponsor the 2016 tournament MVP and on the Fast Girl Skates.
Well, wait, hang on. Mick Swagger is standing at the pivot line conferring, potentially calling another timeout. She hasn't left the line, and the lineup time would about to be over here.
Well, Fast Girl Skates.
And there's another timeout. So Mick Swagger told the jam timer that she wanted that extra timeout.
Ooh, which could have been an official review if she had wanted it to preserve her two additional team timeouts. Yet no. Crime City, 56 points scored this period. Rainy City, 71. They are sitting at 104 points. Crime City, 129. 1 minute and 29 seconds left on the clock.
I've got to be thinking Crime City's bench has to be rattled at this point after that last jam for Mick Swagger to use two consecutive team timeouts and freeze the clock. We're at 129 on the clock as it stands with 25 points separating these two teams.
And this is an Adam Skates, the second team timeout from Rainy City in a row. Adam Skates just got a lot more colorful. Just like our team timeouts.
That's right.
Well, we will have questions for Mick Swagger after this game, won't we, Sasha?
I'm probably going to get Facebook messaged about it when she watches this archive. We're about to get
started.
She'll tell us.
She never doesn't tell us.
She's pretty upfront. So here we go. Crime City with a 25-point lead. If they get lead, they effectively control the clock. They could go long on this one here. It's Curly Hoare trying to get around the brace. Now coming in to assist is Chutet to try and break up the brace, and now going back and bracing her own wall as Vivian Lethal on her way to the box for a forearm penalty. And Chutet with a major hit on Gogo Chanel. Curly Hoare is out on the outside lane.
And just like that, she's got control of the clock. But taking off the helmet cover is Gogo Chanel.
Lap point has been signaled as Curly Hoare coming into the pack. That will be a 5-point pickup. And again, Crime City effectively controls the clock. They can keep running this one through. As Chutet now on her way to the penalty box. And the star has been passed. It has gone to Menace. So Menace now with the opportunity to try and force the call off, or at least try and pick up some points here, or force perhaps a penalty. 57 seconds left to go in the jam, 24 seconds on the period clock. Menace completes a scoring pass for four. Curly Hoare right behind her will complete an additional scoring pass for four. So a 9-4 jam so far.
And her bench saying, run it, keep it calm and run it.
Yeah, get out of this game, basically. It's got to be what they're thinking. And now a signal being shouted from the bench. I'm not sure if you can hear it at home.
They're saying, look at the clock.
For the gym to be called, yeah. There's the call. Period clock has lapsed. And we are going to have an unofficial final. The points were a wash. So 30 points separating the teams. Crime City 142, Rainy City 112 is an unofficial final.
So Crime City able to maintain their fifth seeding coming into this tournament. And they will be number five.
Yeah, Rainy City is coming in seeded seventh. They'll finish sixth. And I think they'll take that. I think they got to be happy with that one.
Yeah, and I'm extremely happy with Curly Hoare's performance in this game. 10 for 12. One of those is one loss lead. So if we're being technical, 11 for 12.
Yeah.
But one box trip, 83% lead jammer status for her. 80 total points in this game and a 60 positive point differential anytime she was on the track.
Yeah, for those of you fantasy derby players out there, you really should have picked Curly Hoare.
I don't have time for fantasy derby because I'm playing real actual roller derby.
Well, I'm not playing real actual roller derby. I just don't have time because I have way too much on my docket.
Agreed. Rainy City posting some really good numbers of their own, a positive differential for Wild of 18. She had four box trips, though, and that in the first period. It plagued her in the first period.
Yeah, all credit to Wild. She completely cleaned her game up, went into a complete state of jamnesia, didn't have a single penalty in that second half. Faye Roberts as well. She started the half at six penalties, never fouled out.
And that was really impressive. We had a number of skaters here with six penalties. Dyke Stalker had six penalties. Chuchet had six penalties. Faye Roberts, Missy Rascal. And again, the fact that they were able to keep their wits about them. Below me, I'm going to call that a freak incident.
Yeah,
where
yeah.
The illegal procedure penalty was just a mistake.
Yeah.
And they happen.
Yeah, as like I said, just a brief mental lapse to where you had to remove the helmet cover. And as you said, a case of an identity crisis. You don't know if you're the pivot or the jammer anymore.
Not a girl, not yet a woman. Who are you?
So she left the box to throw the helmet cover back onto the track, not realizing that once you leave the box, you can't go until you're cleared. And there you go. That's why she got penalized. So let's talk about what's coming up next before we go down to the floor for our post-game interview.
Well, we can see warming up on the track. We are delayed just briefly because we have had a few delays already today. So the next game that will get underway is going to be a doozy.
Oh, yeah. It's going to be Atlanta going up against Jacksonville to determine who gets the bronze medal and who gets the last spot coming out of this tournament for champs.
I thought you were going to say the battle for who can be more Southern.
That's one way
who
to put
it.
I don't know who would win that one, quite frankly, and I don't think I want to try because I may get stabbed in the kidneys.
I think I know who it is. I think it's Sissy Splasic, and she is on the floor, and she looks like she's got our friend Curly Hoare for an interview. Sasha, I'm so glad I got to call this game with you.
I'm glad I got to call with you, Double
H. Thank you for talking to me and to our audience on WFTDA.TV, and now we're going to send it down to the floor to our friend Sissy Splasic.
Hey y'all, that's right, Sissy Splasic here with the captain of Crime City, Curly Hoare.
Hello.
So, big win for y'all. And I know you've played Rainy quite a bit, more than any other team at this tournament. So what did you really do coming into this?
That's us. Yeah, we played them before,
yeah.
And they're always really tough team and really good players. So, we're just glad that we beat them today. And it's also so much fun that they have become so much better and are also in Division One tournament now and playoffs and everything. So it's awesome.
Yeah. So they've been talking about you a lot on the feed today. High score today, 80 points for Crime City today. Did you do anything different or, like, what did you do for this game?
Nothing. Like, I was trying to work with my dead leg, so it was just like, okay, I'm going. And then it's just, yeah.
All right, and will you do me one personal favor? Will you say hi to my Swedish grandfather, my morfar? Yes. His name is Edward Dahl.
Edward Dahl?
Yeah.
Okay. Hey son, Edward Docka. Hur var du?
Yes, he's going to be so happy. You probably just made my mom's whole day. So congrats on your win. We're so happy to have y'all here. Thank have you. A good time. Watch some games.
We will. Thanks.
Thanks, guys.